Hey, good morning. Good to see you guys. My name's Aaron Treadway. I don't always introduce myself, but I recognize that we do have several new people. If you're new, if you're visiting, I just want to extend a very special welcome to you. Just know that you're so welcome in this place. And this is a great day that you've chosen to be here. See, today we are wrapping up a series that's been really important and kind of foundational as we move into this year 2020. We've been talking about what it looks like to live for more. And specifically, we've been talking about what it looks like to actually cultivate a life of significance over success. It's not a normal, it's not necessarily even a popular topic, significance over success in our current culture, but it's a very, very important thing that we're discussing right now in these times. You see, I want you to see something this morning. Research actually suggests that a majority of people, when they come to the end of their life, they have the exact same regrets. So if you had a regret, most people have the same regrets. And I don't want to be morbid this morning, but I want you to see this. Look at what people regret when they come to the end of their life. The first thing that they regret is they spent too much time worrying. I don't know if this is true of you, but research suggests it's true of many people. Number two, too little time with family, with loved ones. They cared perhaps too much about what others think about them. Too much time working. Too much time spent on self. Focused on self. And to me, it's a very interesting list. I came upon it, an organization called the Gallup Organization, which does lots of different polls. They generated this research. And when I saw this, it rang true to me. You see, what I noticed immediately is that no one, when they come to the end of their life, thinks to themselves, I wish I had driven a better car, right? As we research and poll different people, nobody ever thinks to themselves, I wish I lived in a bigger house. And when we come to the end of our life, most of us, I would guess all of us, aren't gonna think to ourselves, I wish I had just made a little bit more money. You see, most of us are in the exact same camp. Listen to how Pastor Greg Laurie, he puts it. He says, in the end, God isn't going to say to you, well done, good and successful servant, but well done, good and faithful servant. See, here's the reality. God knows and values significance over success. And for most of us, when we come to the end of our life, and I know we're not there yet, but when you come to the end of your life, I guarantee if you don't value significance over success right now, that's what's gonna happen. You're gonna realize the value of significance over success. Here's the problem though, at least in our current reality, in our current culture, we live in a culture that says that success should be our greatest prize. So it's in light of this that we've been asking a question throughout this entire month of January. We've been asking this same question, how do you live for something more? And to answer this question, we've been talking about a story about a man. He sat beside a pool, and I'm hoping that most of you have been a part of this at least one or two times, but the Gospel of John records this man's story. It says that for 38 years, this man sat by the side of a pool. He suffered some physical infirmity. And he sat there because he was hoping that at some point he might be made well. You see, the tradition states that there was an angel of the Lord at a certain time, every so often, this angel would come down from heaven, would stir the water, whomever would jump into this water first would be healed. And so that is obviously why this man would sit at this pool for so long. He was hoping, he was believing, he wanted to be made well. And yet that's not what we find with this man's story. See, it wasn't until this man, on one particular day, he encounters Jesus at this pool. Jesus asks a very important question. We've been talking about this. Look at this in the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 6. It says, when Jesus saw this particular man lying there, he learned that he had been in this condition for a long time. Jesus asked this man a question. He says, do you really want to be well? And this is what we've been focusing on for 3 weeks now. We've primarily spoken about how this invalid, the Bible calls him, this invalid responds to this question. Jesus says, do you want to be well? And that's what we've been looking at for 3 weeks now. But here's what I want us to do today. As we wrap up this series, so to speak, and we're going to continue to unpack this idea of what it looks like to live for more into the future. But as we wrap up this specific series, instead of focusing on the invalid, today I want us to focus on three things that Jesus does in this specific scenario. You see, it is a template for how all of us are to live our lives as well. See, here's what we find, and this is what you need to know today. It's impossible to live for the significance of God when you're focused on yourself. It's impossible to live for the significance of God when you're focused on yourself. So one more time this morning, John chapter 5, if you have your Bible, let's read a portion of this story one more time, and you're going to find that today you're going to see the antidote for this thing called self-centeredness. John chapter 5, let's start in verse 1. It says this, sometime later, notice this, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. Notice this is the first thing that Jesus does, right? We were talking about the response of this invalid. Today we're talking about three things Jesus does in this scenario. Here's number one, Jesus went to the people. Do you notice this in verse one? It's fairly obvious. But in this scenario, Jesus didn't actually need to go to this particular pool. It says that Jesus went to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews, right? We talked about in week one that there were three specific feasts that all Jewish people were required to go to Jerusalem to attend. Jesus is in this city for this feast. We don't know exactly what feast it was, but that's why he's there. And so he could have easily chosen to simply hang out with his friends. Jesus could have been reclining at his hotel, and yet that's not what we find that Jesus does. Right? The word says that Jesus went. And it's a very interesting statement because that morning, on that particular day, Jesus went out of his way to the edge of this town, to the fringe of society, to a place that he really wasn't supposed to be. Right? Any good Jewish person could tell you that this particular pool is where all these people that were labeled unclean stayed. That's where the unclean people, the people that you shouldn't really be associated with, that's where they hung out. And yet that's exactly where Jesus went. Notice verse 9. It says, the day on which this took place, right? The day that Jesus goes to this particular pool was a Sabbath. So Jesus was in the wrong place, but he was also there on the wrong day. He was there at the wrong time. It was the Sabbath. It was a day of rest for all Jewish people. According to Jewish law, there was all these different laws and requirements that said specifically you should do no form of work on the day of rest, the Sabbath. And that's why when the Jewish religious elite, they see this man who'd been an invalid for 38 years. He is notorious. Everybody knows that he'd been lying at this pool for all of this time. And these Jewish religious elite, they see this guy and he's walking around the city and now he's carrying something. It's his bed, right? It was just really a mat, but it's his bed and he's walking around the city carrying a bed on his shoulders. And that's why when the Jewish religious elite see this man, they call out to him. And they're like, what in the world are you doing? Like, hey, you over there, come over here. Listen to what they say. Verse 9, verse 10. This is what they say. It is the Sabbath. Right? That's what the Jewish religious elite say to this man. It is the Sabbath. What is the requirement? The law, it forbids you to carry your mat. That's a form of work, right? This guy is out there just carrying his bed on his shoulders. And so, according to Jewish law, he's working. You see, here's what we find, that Jesus actually went to people. He didn't have to go, he wanted to go. He went to the people, and yet here's the second thing that we find in this scenario. When Jesus arrived, when he had gone to people, when he went to them, he always met their physical needs. Jesus always met people's physical needs. Look at verse 8. It says, "Then Jesus said to this man, 'Get up!'" Right? Exclamation. It's emphatic. "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." So it's actually Jesus who told this man to carry his bed on his back. He says, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." And verse 9 says, "At once, the man was cured of his physical infirmity." He picked up his mat and he walked. See, we know, because we've been reading this story, that this man had been an invalid for 38 years. So you can imagine that this is a pretty big deal to this guy, right? In the blink of an eye, in the snap of a finger, after 38 years sitting in the exact same place, doing the exact same things with the exact same people, he meets Jesus, and what happens? He is physically healed. His physical need has been immediately met. And to me, it's amazing. And I'm guaranteeing that everyone around thought that this was a total miracle. And to me, it's so obvious that it was very, very, very important to this man that his physical need was met. And yet we find Jesus knew that this man, just like every other person, has one much greater need. See, I want you to see this, the third thing that Jesus does in this scenario. Jesus always meets people's spiritual needs. See, after Jesus went to this guy at this particular pool, after he had healed him of his physical need, his physical infirmity, Jesus sees this guy at the temple later on the very same day, and listen to what Jesus says in verse 14. He says, "See, you are well again." Here it is. "Stop sinning, or something worse might happen to you." And maybe you think to yourself, well, what could be worse than actually sitting in the same place with the same people for 38 years? But Jesus is very quick to tell this man that his sin would actually lead to a much greater problem in his life. See, that's what Jesus is telling this man at this particular moment. In this scenario, we find Jesus went to the people. We find that Jesus healed, that he met people's physical needs. And most important, we find Jesus meets people's spiritual needs. And it's great that Jesus does this. And it's amazing and it is miraculous that Jesus does all of these different things. But here's what we need to understand, especially this morning, that this scenario is not just Jesus doing some miraculous works, but it is actually serving as a template. It can serve as a template for anyone, for all of us. If you want to live for the significance of God, then Jesus says, "Here, follow me. Here is a model, here is a template for you to follow." Right? So I hope you wrote that down. Let me show you what I mean this morning. Matthew chapter 10. Find it. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 10. It's the story about Jesus sending out this ragtag group of guys. Right? It's these tax collectors, and you've got these different fishermen, and he's pulled them all together. The Bible calls them and gives them a title. They're called the 12 disciples. Right? And this story in Matthew 10 records when Jesus is about to send them out on, let's call it, their first mission trip. Right? He has an assignment for these first 12 guys, and he is now, as they're walking out the door, about to give them some final instructions. Look at verse 5, Matthew 10, verse 5. Jesus tells them as they're walking out the door, do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Here's what he says, go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. So don't go to the Gentiles, but go to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. So verse 8, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, so go and freely give to others. It's very interesting advice, because this is the same exact advice that Jesus gives to 11 out of these 12 same guys that went out on that first mission trip right at the end of his life. Right before Jesus ascends to sit at the right hand, they are standing, 11 of the 12 disciples and Jesus, on this big mountain. It's in Galilee, this city. And look at Matthew 28, very popular passage of scripture, verse 19. It's known as the Great Commission. You see, this is the same advice that we find here. It says, then Jesus came to these 11 of the 12. He said, all authority in heaven, on earth, has been given to me. Therefore, what's he say? Go, make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything that you've seen, that you've heard, and that I have commanded you. You see, this is the template that we find that Jesus modeled at the pool. Right, the pool of Bethesda, the pool that this invalid sat at for 38 years, in these verses that we've just looked at, in these other gospels, it's the same exact template. Jesus says, this is what I want from you. Follow after this pattern that I've laid out. Right? You saw me do it. You heard me talk about it. Now you go do it as well. See, Jesus went to people, so he tells the 12, go. Right? In both these scriptures, he says go. And in the Great Commission, we know that it's actually a verb, this word go. So it actually literally translates, be always going. To whom? To make disciples, to the lost sheep, if you remember Matthew chapter 10, verse 5. Be always going to the people. That's what Jesus tells the disciples. That's what Jesus communicates to us. He says, when you find these people, meet their physical needs. What's Jesus tell the 12? He's sending them out on this mission trip. He tells them to heal the sick. What else does he say? Anyone? Raise the dead. Do you remember? We just read it. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cleanse those that have leprosy. Drive out demons. Right? Meet their physical needs. And yet that's not all. There's one more thing Jesus told the 12 disciples. I want you to preach a very specific message. Right? He says, when you are out going, you are always going. Not just go once, not just go one time to one place. Be always going. And when you're meeting people's physical needs along the way, make sure that you preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. You see, if you are a follower of Jesus, you are instructed. In fact, you, whether you know it or not, you carry the message of the kingdom of God inside of you. And Jesus commands us, right? This is the Great Commission. He commands every one of his followers to be always going, meeting people's needs, and communicating this great message of the kingdom of God. To bring people to a knowledge of his Father. And then, not just that, but to be raising them up as true disciples. And I think this is a very simple pattern that Jesus lays out. It feels pretty straightforward. And it's actually the secret to a life of significance. See, I saved the best for last. This is the secret. If you want a life of significance, not just a life of success, maybe you might want to write this down. Ready? Here it is. Maybe write this down. If you want to experience the fullness of God in your life, you want to cultivate a life of significance, not just success. Here's what you need to do. Very simple. Serve others before you serve yourself. Kind of stings a little bit. If you want a life of significance, I saved the best for last. This is it. This is where you go. Here's where you begin. Serve others before you serve yourself. Listen to Paul's instructions in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. He says, do nothing. There's not really a lot of room there. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. Each of you and I should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude, okay, now he's going to drill down a little bit further. It's getting even more painful for some of us, or most of us, or all of us. He says, here's where your attitude should be. Your attitude should be the same as Jesus, who being the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. See, Jesus made himself nothing. He took on the very nature of a servant. He took on the nature of a servant, even though he was God and he was made in human likeness. Being found in the appearance as a man, the word says he humbled himself. He became obedient to death, even a horrific, horrible death on a cross. Look at Luke 22. Here's what Jesus says of himself. Luke 22, verse 27. Jesus says this. He says, who is more important? He's asking a question. The one who sits at the table or the one who serves? Right? Who's more important? Let's just kind of simple question. Who's more important? The one who sits in the table where all the important people sit, or the one who actually is serving? Jesus said it's obviously the one who sits at the table. Of course. I like this. Then Jesus says, but not here. But not here, not in the kingdom of God. No, Jesus says, for I am among you, not as one who came to be served, you see what it says? But as one who serves. So the Son of God, who left the throne of authority to come down into the messy middle of our reality, says, I didn't come to sit at the table of authority, I came to humble myself and to serve. It's very interesting. You see, Jesus is God, but it's clear Jesus came to serve. And so here's my question this morning. Is this your attitude? Is this your mindset? Is it your objective in life to serve others before you serve yourself? Don't raise your hand, just think about these questions. Is this your heart to serve others before you serve yourself? And if I'm honest, and I think if we were all honest, this is really, really, I try to think of a better word, but really hard. I mean, it's extremely difficult, this teaching on how we cultivate a life of significance. Jesus says, in the kingdom of God, if you want to be great, what must you become? A servant. If you want significance, you must become a servant. If you want significance, you can't live to get. You have to live to give your life away. Again, it's not easy. I'm not sharing this morning thinking to yourself, well, obviously, I'll just go and do that. I'll humble myself and my attitude will be exactly the same as Christ Jesus in every single circumstance and situation that I find myself in. And yet that's what we're instructed to do. The Word of God tells us this should be our mindset. This should be our posture, our demeanor as we walk around and live our lives. Not to live to get, but to live to give our lives away. This is the way of the kingdom. And I find it funny, and maybe you've noticed this, that God always gives us opportunity to practice what we preach. You see, just last week, and if you were here last week, you'll know that I spent the week last week in Africa. I was in this city called Kigali in the country of East Africa in Rwanda. And last week, I took what felt like the world's longest flight home, back to Cleveland. started in Kigali, Rwanda. I wanted to get back to you here in Cleveland. But for some reason, this flight went from Kigali to Bujumbura, Burundi, not noted on my itinerary, to Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, not noted on my itinerary, from Addis Ababa, Ethiopia to Brussels, from Brussels to Newark. I didn't have to go to Chicago, from Newark here to Cleveland. Bink, 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 bink. It felt like the world. See, you don't want to travel with me. You think it's glamorous. It's really not, right? I just love what I get to do for the kingdom. I endure the travel, right? I actually spent that day kind of flying. It took me like 30-something hours to get back from that city to here. I don't think it should have. It's kind of like a bus stopping. It's an airplane, but it was a bus. And it just stopped and let people on, and people got off. And I'm like, well, good traveling with you. See you next time, right? And so I actually was sitting there the whole day writing a sermon on how to live for the significance of God, right? I was actually studying and writing this very sermon about if you want significance, you've got to actually serve others before you serve yourself. So this gets really good here because I'm now gonna get on the night flight, and I've waited in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia for like 6 hours. It's the middle of the night, it's 1 a.m, and I'm exhausted. And so I'm praying a very specific prayer. You know you can pray very specifically to God, right? I'm asking God, I just want an exit row seat, right? You don't even have to upgrade me here, God. Just give me an exit row. I'm gonna recline, the legs are gonna stick out, and I'm gonna sleep. That's my prayer. And you know, you can pray these things, and I get on this plane, and you know what happens? Exit row. Praise God, I'm in the exit row, and even better, there is nobody in this middle seat. And some of you don't travel, and you're thinking to yourself, this is just boring, but this is really important stuff, right? 8.5 hours from Addis Ababa to Brussels. And so, I'm exhausted, but I'm just praising God. I'm starting to sing a worship song, and the doors close, and the plane starts to push back from the gate. And so I'm like, yes, this is happening. I put my earplugs in. I've got my eye mask on. My hair is still done perfectly, believe it or not, right? I'm gonna sleep, and that's just a little side note. I am falling asleep right into blissful dreamland. Earplugs in, eye mask on, hair done perfectly. When some lady from the very back of the plane gets up with, couldn't have been more than 3 to 6 months old, brand new baby, and sits in the very middle seat, right next to me. And so I'm pretending like it's not happening, but it is, right? It is happening. So I go into specific prayer mode again, and I'm not proud of this, but I was praying, oh God, make her go away, right? I'm not proud of it. I'm just being honest. I'm your pastor. And so I'm telling you, oh God, please make her go away. But I decide to persevere. She is not going away. She is clearly going to sit here for 8.5 hours. And so I put my eye mask back on. I've got my earplugs in, and I am about to fall asleep. I mean, I probably was asleep. And that is the moment where this lady, she takes the baby and places her on my lap. No communication, no discussion, just places the baby on my lap. And it's interesting because that is where the baby stayed for the next 8.5 hours, right? The baby was either feeding with its head on my shoulder or sleeping or playing or crying on my lap. We never talked about this, right? I wish I could tell you at the end of this story, I wish that this was the case, right? I almost thought of an alternative ending, but this not. I did not lead this woman to Christ, right? I love that ending when we turn the corner, but I led her to Jesus, everybody. That's not what happened here. She never once spoke to me, not one single word. See, she was sleeping the whole flight while I was entertaining her baby on my lap. Oh, you laugh. Wait until this happens to you. See, Paul tells us, do nothing. I could have had a very bad attitude, and the truth is I did at some point in this 8.5 hours. You know how many hours I slept? Zero. Not one single second. I got an entertainment baby on my lap, and thank goodness I have a baby or I would not know what to do. Paul says, do nothing. Absolutely nothing out of selfish ambition. Do nothing out of vain conceit. In humility, we're instructed to consider others. I think the problem is so often when we begin to consider others, it's very difficult because we are focused on ourselves. We are praying about ourselves. All of what we are aimed at is ourselves. And I don't know, have you ever noticed this? Right? Have you ever noticed that so often we're entirely too focused on what we want or our own desires or our own needs in that moment? See, let me ask you a question, and it's really a silly little thing, but let's just say a photographer snaps a group photo and you happen to be there, right? And you are now looking at this photo. Think about this. And you're looking at this picture. Who is the first person that you look for in the group photo? Right? You can answer honestly. I'm not saying you're not a Christian. It's yourself, right? You look at a group photo and you look for yourself and you base whether you think that is a good photo or not on how you look. You're laughing because you know it's true, right? We all do this. I'm not saying you're not a Christian. I'm not saying you're a bad person. All I'm saying, this is what we need to understand. It's impossible, according to God's word, to live for his significance, to live for something greater when you are focused on yourself. This is a real challenge, especially in our culture. You see, we live in this culture that says success should be our ultimate prize. Not significant, success. And so often we feel content. And we talked about this in week one. So often we'll feel, when we think about our life, we'll feel, well, things are good enough. But this is what you need to ask yourself. What if God has more? See, what if God actually wants to do more in your life? Maybe God wants to bless you more. Maybe God wants to add more of his fullness to your life. You see, we find that Jesus left all of us a template on how to live for his significance. And it just so happens that it is also the antidote for this thing we call self-centeredness. Right? We have this very clear picture of how we overcome our self-centered vision through this template. We find that Jesus went to people. And so let me ask you a few questions. You see, this is the first thing, Jesus went to people. So I wonder, who in your life do you need to go to? Who comes to your mind? Think about this right now, as you sit there right now. Who comes to your mind when you think about people who are in your life right now who are hurting, who are struggling, who might maybe just might need you to come along? People who have settled for perhaps for something less than God's best in their life. See, I want to challenge you. Write that name down. Write those few names down right now, right where you sit. I'm challenging you this week to actually go and seek them out. See, it's one thing we think to ourselves, well, I'm thinking about you. Right, I see this on social media all the time. Thinking good thoughts, right? That doesn't really help me at all, right? And you can step it up. I am praying for you, and I think that's a very important thing to do. Keep praying. But I think it's even equally, if not more important, to be praying, but then go. Right? We can't just say we're thinking nice thoughts. We are praying. If you know somebody that's struggling, Jesus says, go. Be always going, meeting people where they're at. And when you go, here's what Jesus says to do: meet their physical needs. So again, a question. Who in your life has some unmet physical need that you can help with? Maybe at work, right? Maybe it's not just your family. Maybe it's at work. Maybe it's in your neighborhood. Maybe you work out, so maybe it's at the gym. Who can you lift up? Who can you help back onto their feet? See, I wonder how many of us actually know a poor person. Just a question I'm throwing out there. Do you know somebody who has need? See, if you don't, I'm here to tell you it's not an excuse. Right? You might say to yourself, well, I just don't know any people who have needs around me. There's nobody in my life that has needs. So I am suggesting, if that is the case, go back to point one. Right? Go meet people where they're at. Meet their physical needs. And most important, when you meet them and you meet their physical needs, also carry the message of the kingdom of God. Meet their spiritual need. See, who in your life needs to know and understand this great love of Jesus for them? Just like this man at the pool who's spiritually lame or spiritually blind or spiritually paralyzed, that you can help point to the one, the only one who saves. You see, it's simply not good enough to think to yourself, someone else will carry this message to your friends or your family or your neighbors. You see the word in there? Your, right? These are your relationships. God has given you these relationships for a purpose. And the greatest purpose, the highest purpose, is that you would make known Jesus in their life. See, that's why I'm here, and I believe the word says that's why you are here. Not to get, but to give our life away. It's the only way that I can see to actually live for the significance of God. It is the antidote as well to this life of self-centeredness. And the reality is, just like all things, because you've got free will, you get to choose. Right? It'd be easier if God just made us focus on others before we focus on ourselves. You get to choose. So listen to what Pastor David Platt once said. He says, you and I, we can choose to continue with business as usual in the Christian life and in the church as a whole, enjoying success based on the standards defined by the culture around us. Or we can take an honest look at the Jesus of the Bible and we can dare to ask what the consequences might be if we really believed him and we really chose to follow his lead. You see, we get to choose whether or not we live for the significance of God. You get to choose how you spend your one and only life this side of heaven. You can choose success, but I think that in the end you're going to find, when you stand before God, that success didn't really matter as much as you thought. So I want you to think about this idea that the Bible talks about. That one day you are going to stand before God. It doesn't matter who you are, and it doesn't matter what you've accomplished, and it doesn't matter where you're from. One day, all of us are going to stand in front of God, and I'm telling you, on the authority of God's word, you will not hear God say, man, I just wish that you had done a little bit more for yourself. Right? I guarantee when you stand in front of God, God is not going to look at you and say, I can't believe you drove that car. Right? God is not going to say, I can't believe you lived in that teeny tiny little house. These are not the words that you're going to hear the creator of all things say to you on that day. You see, I promise that God will not look at you. He will not survey and examine your life and say, well done, good and successful servant. See, God's not looking for success. He's looking for faithful obedience. And so as we wrap up this morning, I just want to pray a simple prayer for you. We began this series asking an important question. What do you live for? And so in this moment, just for a few seconds, I want you to think about that question. What do you live for? Would you close your eyes? Can we bow our heads? This is a moment between you and God. Think about this idea, this question. What am I living for? What is my purpose? When I stand before God, what do I want to hold up as, hey God, this is what I did with my life. This is what I spent my time and my talents and my energy pursuing. This was my greatest pursuit. This was my greatest objective. What do you live for? You see, it's only the glory of God, which is his significance, which lasts for eternity. And so, Father, I am praying this morning that you would help each of us consider others better than ourselves. That you would help us to humble ourselves. Just as the Lord Jesus Christ came and humbled himself, even to death on a cross, that we would be willing, that we would be excited to take up this role of a servant. God, we know that that is only possible through you. We confess how we've got it wrong. We confess how we've aimed at our own significance and our own success. So, Father, give us willing hearts and a great conviction that we are here to serve others before we serve ourselves. Father, we love you. We thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you that even when we don't want to receive it, when we don't want to hear it, it convicts us and it calls us to even more. So God, won't you take this morning and use it all for your glory. And we, your people, pray these things in the power, for the glory, for the majesty of our King and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.